Girls Ontario International Women's Day Conference for women and those who identify as female. My name is Antonia Levy, and I am the Young Women's Initiatives Program Coordinator with Skills Ontario. Promoting the skilled trades and technologies as viable and valuable careers to youth has been the goal of Skills Ontario for over 30 years. Today, we are ready to get real and have some thought-provoking conversations about some things women deal with when advancing their careers in the skilled trades and technologies. Skills Ontario is abiding by all health and safety guidelines as instructed by public health authorities and is following protocol to ensure our team is continuing to operate safely and responsibly. Before we begin, I want to acknowledge that the province of Ontario is situated on the traditional territory of the Anishinaabe, Haudenosaunee, Huron-Wendat, Cree, and the Métis people. There are 46 treaties covering the province of Ontario, including 3 numbered treaties, 2 Robinson treaties, 2 Williams treaties, and 30 Upper Canada treaties. Skills Ontario recognizes and deeply appreciates their historic connection to this place. We also recognize the contributions Indigenous peoples have made in shaping and strengthening our community. International Women's Day is a day to recognize women, their contributions and achievements, and we are proud to be supporting this initiative once again this year. International Women's Day is recognized by the United Nations to help empower women and put an end to discrimination. This year, the theme is Break the Bias, imagining a gender-equal world, a world free of bias, stereotype, and discrimination. A world that's diverse, equitable, and inclusive. A world where difference is valued and celebrated. International Women's Day is a day to stand together in unity, supporting all women and encouraging them to follow their passions and to excel. Today, we are going to tackle some tough conversations, but conversations that need to be talked about. It is about learning, growing, and being equipped with strategies to overcome any obstacles that one may face when entering the skilled trades and technologies. Together, we are stronger. Together, we can forge women's equality. Together, we can all break the bias. Skills Ontario is proud to be Ontario's leader for promoting skilled trades and technologies to young women. Through our Young Women's Initiative program, we offer some pretty awesome events that are engaging and educational, such as our regional career exploration events, our young women's conferences, and opportunities like this one to present to all women that not only is there a place for them in skilled trades, but also provide them with the tools to empower and challenge the world around them. If you have further questions about the conference or our many exciting programs, please email Skills Ontario or visit our website. We are so excited about what we have to offer you today. We will be proudly introducing you to some amazing women and leaders who work across the province to promote the skilled trades and technologies. Let's begin with some housekeeping items. 1. Although our content for today's event will be spoken in English, we will also include French closed captioning. 2. Connect with us. Follow us on social media. 3. To go along with the 2022 theme, International Women's Day has an official hashtag, Break the Bias, that we encourage you to use when posting about the event. 4. At Skills Ontario, we have also created our own event hashtag, just for our event here today. Our special event hashtag is hashtag SkillsIWD2022. Take a picture watching this conference, doing something skilled trade related, or in the Break the Bias post for International Women's Day 2022, and share it on social media. Tag at Skills Ontario and use hashtag SkillsIWD2022. And finally, 5, you can connect with us today by sharing your valuable feedback with us. At the end of this conference, there will be a post-event survey, and we greatly appreciate your feedback so we can continue making our events even better. Lastly, I would like to take the time to recognize our long-standing partnership with the federal and provincial governments and also thank our Young Women's Initiatives program sponsors, Magna and General Motors. At this time, I would like to welcome Jen Cowdery from General Motors to say a few words.
Empowering, courageous, hardworking, empathetic, innovative, proud. Those are all words that describe what being a woman means to me. Hi, my name is Jen Cowdery. I'm an electrical chassis HVAC quality engineer at the General Motors Cami Assembly Plant in Ingersoll, Ontario. And I truly do love my job and I enjoy coming to work each day. It wasn't always this easy though. Growing up, I lived in the country on a hobby farm and I also worked on a farm in St. Mary's, Ontario. My dad was a diesel mechanic, and between the farm and my dad, I quickly started picking up wrenches and helping to fix the tractors and transports. From there, my love of the trades quickly grew into me taking all of the automotive and woodworking classes available at my high school. My dad grew anxious though, as he saw my love for the automotive trade. He always said he wanted better for me than what he had. He even went to my high school to ask my automotive teacher not to get me to like auto class anymore. So then when I graduated high school, I won the Automotive Scholarship Award and I chose to attend Fanshawe College in the Motive Power Technician program, much to my dad's dismay. I just really enjoyed learning how things work and taking things apart. I was the only girl in my college program, but that didn't stop me from pursuing my love for automotive. I graduated with honors and I pulled wrenches at a dealership in St. Mary's. It was there that I had to break through another barrier. I heard one of the technicians saying, "Not a girl." But throughout the year, I quickly changed their female bias because I wasn't afraid to get dirty. These barriers and perceptions about women in the trades is what we all need to help break through. So with conversations like these and telling each of our stories, we will succeed in eliminating barriers to women in the trades. At General Motors, we empower women to be their own advocate in pursuing the trades. We're dedicated to challenging stereotypes that exist in the trades and encouraging women to drive your own success. Be your own brand and pursue what you believe in. Apprenticeship programs, employee resource groups like the Women in Manufacturing and Diversity and Inclusion Group, and this Young Women's Initiative with Skills Ontario, these are all helping to eliminate discrimination and bias in the trades. So if you like taking things apart like me or learning how things work, we're all here to limit any barriers you may face and work collectively to push through them. We're here to stand behind women in realizing their goals and dreams and support you in your relentless desire to pursue the trades. So what empowers you? What can you do to help make the world a more inclusive place for women in the trades? This is our time to challenge the status quo.
Thank you so much, Jen, for sharing your experiences with us. Before we begin, let's review our agenda for the day. To start, we will have the Honorable Jane McKenna, Associate Minister of Children and Women's Issues, to offer some welcoming remarks. Following our warm welcome, we will dive right into our main message, focusing on how we can support women in the skilled trades and technologies, how we can limit discrimination, and how employers can remove barriers for women and underrepresented groups in the skilled trades. After the main message, we will jump into our first panel discussion, where we will tackle the conversation on discrimination in the workplace and strategies on how to overcome it. Next, we will be joined by two amazing women for an HR Real Talk segment on health and safety. And lastly, we will wrap up our event with our final panel discussion on the importance of allyship in the skilled trades and technologies. At this time, I would like to introduce and welcome the Honorable Jane McKenna, Associate Minister of Children and Women's Issues. Thank you for joining us, Minister.
I am delighted to be wishing so many bright young women a happy and empowering International Women's Day. This global event is a day to celebrate the achievements and leadership of women around the world. This year's theme is #BreakTheBias, because the truth is, despite how far we've come, many biases still exist in our society, and many of you may have been exposed to some throughout your own journeys. Whether deliberate or unconscious, bias makes it difficult for women to move ahead. Knowing that bias exists isn't enough. Action is needed to level the playing field. We can all play a part in breaking the bias by actively calling out gender bias, discrimination, and stereotyping each time we see it. As Associate Minister of Children and Women's Issues, I am working hard to break down barriers for women in our province to make sure that they are respected and valued in the workplace, are being paid fairly, and given opportunities to advance into leadership positions. As a mother of four daughters, I will give you the same advice I give them. I encourage you to be curious, ask questions, and trust in yourself. By choosing to explore a career in skilled trades and technology, you are already making a difference. Women make up half of the Canadian workforce, yet the perception still exists that certain jobs, particularly skilled trade jobs, should only be done by men. You are breaking this bias and building a more diverse workforce. I know that you will all continue to make a difference and create your own great stories. And I look forward to hearing of your successes as we gather again at future International Women's Day events in the years to come. Thank you so much for having me. I wish you all an empowering International Women's Day.
Thank you so much to the Honorable Jane McKenna for her insightful words to all the women watching today and for joining us in the celebration of Skills Ontario's International Women's Day. Next up, we would like to introduce you to a trailblazer in her industry, Miriam Jordy, who will talk about how we can support women, how we can limit discrimination, and how employers can remove barriers for women and underrepresented groups in the skilled trades and technologies. Please welcome Miriam.
Hi. I would like to thank the organizers of Skills Ontario for inviting me to be a part of this International Women's Day event. I know that a lot of hard work and energy went into this, and I hope you will feel enriched after hearing from all the speakers throughout the day. It is important for me to talk about women in the trades because of all the little things that came up for me working in male-dominated spaces throughout my career. I'd like to lead by saying that 90% of my journey was excellent, and the other 10% was noticeably uncomfortable or downright toxic. I'd also like to point out that I can only speak for myself. It is important to have an open dialogue to talk about the truth and what minorities and women are up against and how each of us can reach out to create the kind of connections where we can support each other in our careers. I hope that we can all take something away from the messages of the day that help lift us up and also the other women and girls we come across on our journey. It is my hope that going forward, we can be the change that we would like to see in the industry by strengthening our support networks. There truly is strength in numbers, and I'd like to encourage each and everyone here today to make a vow to support other women, whether you like them or not, because the number of women in skilled trades remains to be around 5% at best on the tools. Please do not participate in gossip and other low behavior that pulls our sisters down. Everyone who is here deserves to be here. It's not an easy job, and I don't know a tradeswoman who hasn't worked twice as hard to be where she is today. My name is Miriam Jordy. I'm a journeyperson sheet metal worker by trade. In the last year, I made an important move to a new city, and while looking at job options, I have decided to cross trades to work at a national general contractor named Shandos Construction, and I now have a role as a project coordinator. A general contractor is a management company in construction who arranges everything it takes to build the buildings for our clients from the ground up, including considerations to timeline, budget, subtrades, and materials, everything, actually just everything. As a project coordinator, I assist the project manager, and I'm working towards that level. I also started a Facebook group called Alberta Women in the Trades and Ontario Women in the Trades, and New Brunswick Women in the Trades, which are groups run by and full of actual tradeswomen and those looking for apprenticeship advice. I would also like to take a brief minute to mention that nothing I have accomplished I did on my own, because it really does take the greater community of support in order to be successful in this space. In this case, about 20 admins across my groups and many more when you look at our sister groups from all of the other provinces. Some things that I would like to mention would be that trying to find my career, I tried lots of different jobs. Tree planting, an art therapy program at a community art center, Safeway, an interior decorator for a builder. My favorite jobs were hands-on, outdoorsy, very artistic, or just chasing adventure. In the year 2000, I got married and I had two kids. So at that time, my jobs mostly revolved around my family and being a mom. After 10 years of marriage, my partner and I separated and I found myself needing a way better paying job than what I had at the time. At the time, I was a decorator at a renovation company, which paid $35,000 a year, and I was living in a basement suite. I knew that I needed to make a lot more money in order to give my kids the life that I wanted for them. I had imagined what I wanted, and I even made a vision board. I wanted a house. I wanted a lot more money, and I wanted security. So I started looking for opportunities. When I was looking around, I came across an ad in Kijiji about women in trades, and it was an upskilling program put on by the YWCA and Vermilion Energy. The program was based on the SAIT first year's modules for carpentry. It was designed to give women the tools needed to get started in the trades. I quit my job and signed up. That was one of the best decisions I ever made. They encouraged us to explore our options, and after falling in love with welding, I found a job in a sheet metal shop. When I saw what sheet metal actually was, I was excited about how interesting it seemed. A career filled with building and installing everything from ductwork to stainless steel cabinetry and sophisticated hospital and lab equipment. Also furnaces and welding. The variety was amazing and I never got bored. It took me 5 years instead of four to get my ticket in 2017, but I more than doubled my income in those years and nearly tripled my income by year eight. I would have never guessed that I would find my work in construction, because ironically, I grew up around construction. My dad was an independent builder and a journeyman carpenter. I was definitely aware of construction. It was not foreign to me, but for some reason I was blind to it as an option. I should give some credit to my dad, though. He said that I should be a construction manager when I was 17. I guess I took the long road, but at the time I didn't know any women who were doing it, and it was hard to imagine a career as it was as a teenager, let alone a career which would be filled with all kinds of barriers. Looking back, I see that lots of my skills were actually transferable. The tree planting, the arts, the decorating, and the odd jobs, nobody explained that to me. So for those of you looking, just keep trying things. No education or experience is ever a waste of time. So now let's talk about what I noticed immediately upon entering the trades world. I immediately saw that there were not very many women, and that there were some pretty tasteless jokes and comments directed at me sometimes. Luckily, I had a good number of awesome male journeymen to teach me and sometimes to stick up for me, but the work culture was noticeable. And as an example, I would have to say that my boss used to make this joke about me. Whenever I was kneeling, he would say, "On your knees again, Miriam." And it was supposed to be like a bit of a sexual innuendo. But yeah, I'm only going to use that one example, but I can assure you that if you wanted a list of examples of all the little off-colored comments made over my career, you might find it shocking. I had days where those comments really got to me. And it wasn't just the comments, it was that nobody ever did anything about them. Most of my career, I didn't mention it. I did start to be a little bit smarter about who I was working with and eventually even where I worked. I started looking for female mentors for emotional support and words of advice on how I could better communicate when I found myself at the wrong end of a bad joke or after another lewd comment about my body was said. After I got my ticket, I had been at one company for my whole apprenticeship, and I had decided to try a completely different work environment to see if that would be the difference I needed. And I found myself briefly in BC for work. While I was there, I stumbled upon a support network called BC Women in the Trades, and it was so useful. It was a safe space filled with over 1,000 journey women and people with lots of experience. As I read through it, I knew that this was what Alberta women needed also. When I came home from BC, I was hesitant to start an Alberta group, mostly because I'm naturally shy and I was honestly waiting for someone else to do it. Finally, at the end of 2019, I was in a place where I felt confident enough to give it a go. And with the help of my child, a friend, my sister, I got the positive kind of peer pressure that we sometimes rely on in our lives, and I created the group. The group exploded, and in just one month, we had 400 members, and in 6 months, we had 1,000. And now, today, there are over 2,000 members. This wasn't just a stroke of pure luck and timing, although that was certainly part of it. It had a lot to do with some simple networking that I had been doing on my own for years. Looking for connections and trying to force visual representation of women in trades on the internet. In 2015, if you Googled women in trades or construction, the only things that you would find were jokes about women building sandwiches or about women in hard hats not knowing what they were doing. I started a humble little blog called Quest 365, where I made a deal with myself that I would post photos of trades-related topics every day, and I would produce features of women who I came across on the job site. Very simple, basic features, who she was, what apprenticeship or title she had, and a tiny piece, no more than a paragraph, on how she got into her trade. Doing this simple blog meant that I made myself approachable to every woman on a job site. A lot of those women were the first women I invited to the group, and then they invited their friends and connections and so on. Again, I cannot express enough that the women on your sites and in your shops are your biggest allies, and they are key to creating a better environment in our industries. Did you know that in 2019, virtually all of the construction and trades related memes used to be just about men? And the few that existed about women were just about making fun of them. It was all sexist. And I thought a good way to get representation was to create our own memes. I'm not the first one who did it, but I certainly pushed it in my circles. I made probably 100 myself, and I encouraged women to put that out there because it was a fun way to take up the space we wanted to occupy. Visible representation matters. And when we document our journeys, whether it's through a relatable joke or by showing a TikTok of how workwear fits, it's showing the world what we need and what we want, and we're asking them to acknowledge us. Again, everything I've done was only successful because those of us who wanted to see the changes became catalysts of change ourselves. And it came about through a progression of simply taking up more space. So the main changes that have taken place for tradeswomen over the past 10 years, as I see it, have been the following. One very important one is that women can now go to more than one place for support. Groups on Facebook, individuals on Instagram and TikTok, more and more programs every year that can support you getting into the trades through your school or through industry or not-for-profits. Basically, we now have a community that reaches across the country. Another thing worth mentioning was the Me Too movement happened, and awareness about sexual harassment in the industry is happening. Because of the supports, women are now able to speak up without losing everything. Women with these support systems in place can talk about the environment with other women and make educated choices around whether they should stay in a situation and face it or cut their losses and move on. This keeps women safer, and many women that I talk to starting out now have been able to avoid a lot of the really bad sexual harassment issues. Someone from the Alberta and BC group was able to take her situation and start a group called Justice for Women in Trades. These changes came from women having the courage to speak up, and it's making all the difference. I want to encourage you all to use your voices. If something doesn't feel right at your job, not only about sexual harassment, but all the issues, reach out and talk to someone in your network. Also, use your voices to ask. Ask for clothing and PPE that fit. Be brave enough to stand up for yourself and others. Combat the glass ceiling or anything that is holding you back. Women are creating their own groups and communities, and by doing so, they are safer and so are you. So another thing is that the industry is shifting to changing their ways. In that 10 years ago, many trades companies didn't have an HR department. And if they did, it wasn't real. And what I mean by that is that it was not really safe to report anything without it turning into your problem more than theirs. And it was definitely not confidential. I know that it is very much still the case in a lot of the industry. So choose your companies wisely. They are starting to understand how important people are. So look for companies that are doing something meaningful about the issues of harassment, diversity and inclusion, and mental health. I know sometimes it's just a lot of talk and policies don't mean a lot without action, but definitely check out the company's website and try to do some digging to make sure that they have a proper HR representative and that the company's values align with your own. Always remember, a toxic male work culture can be more than just a pain in the ass to deal with. It can be dangerous. Do your due diligence, and if you're in a bad environment, don't think that you can change, then leave, because life is too short. Some of the reasons that I think joining the trades, and in particular the construction industry, is a good option for women are the following in no particular order. Money. It pays well, and you make money while you're training. The apprenticeship model makes a lot of sense that way. Staying physically fit. I never felt in better shape. I felt strong. I'm a type 2 diabetic, and I was always getting enough exercise that it actually kept that in check. Super interesting work for the right person. It's good work for people who like to work with their hands, solve problems, be resourceful, make something work better, and troubleshoot. You become very proud of yourself as you learn more and more skills. It's called a journey because you literally never stop learning your entire career. And you can really see the results of your knowledge and expertise. After you have your journey person ticket, you can head in many directions. You can even bridge trades, as I've done. There's a huge amount of upward growth you can access. It becomes something you are proud of. As long as you stand up for yourself and put your career and happiness first, you'll be able to navigate the sometimes difficult career path. And at the end, the result can look many different ways. Word to the wise, forget about the people who are threatened by you. Instead, talk with leaders who are interested in your career ambitions. So what about some of the challenges that still remain? The work culture. It's a very male-dominated space. Traditionally, you didn't need an education to work in the industry. You still don't. When women started to show up, a lot of men were unhappy about it because they felt women were ruining something that they had. There is still a lot of locker room talk. You will need to know where to draw your line and what you will accept. That is a very individual thing, but I think I can safely say that rape culture, as it is referred to, can be rather insidious. Jokes like, on your knees again, who hired the stripper, I know who I'd like to screw or hammer, etc., are no longer appropriate, and for the other stuff, tone and context is everything. But if it feels wrong to you, get in the habit of saying something about it right away. Be direct, because you are part of the shift that's happening in this culture for everyone. The concept of having a thick skin to exist is probably still a bit true, but I personally don't think that you should have a skin as thick as an elephant's for this journey. I know for me, it got old really fast. I was a respectable mother of two, and I didn't always want to put up with these things. And I had to develop a special set of skills just to exist. Women in male-dominated sectors still have to put a lot more thought into how they navigate the environment. I believe that the industry is starting to wake up. And I know I have found that being fussy about where I work has helped me. It's important to note that these jobs are not for everyone. You have to want to be physically active all day and enjoy being dirty. Tradespeople come home at the end of the day tired and dirty. You have to be determined and push yourself a lot. The job stability in the industry is not always available. You might be laid off after a project is over, so you have to be good with money. Sometimes you have to stretch it for a little bit to make it to the next build or contract. And childcare is ever an issue. It's difficult for parents as the hours of these jobs can start before daycare is even open, and often work is out of town. You really need to hunt down the right situation as a parent, but I did it, and I know other women who have done it. But depending on the age of the children and what kind of support you have, it can be an impossible hurdle. I'd like to see companies becoming more creative and offering more flexible and convenient options for everyone. I have a lot of hope in the changes that will come out of more women speaking up about the issues. I think industry is starting to be more open to ideas, and here are some of the things I'd like to see. I'd love to see a better reporting system for women and minorities to allow for anonymous reporting. The repercussions of reporting can be the end of your career. Companies and unions need to have formal support systems in place, and individuals need to be protected and supported when they voice their concerns. I truly have seen amazing things in my now 11-year career through women coming together and becoming one loud voice. I strongly believe that women will be the change this industry requires to create the kind of environment more people will want to work in. Women are leading the changes that create a more professional environment in the trades and are opening doors by extending rights and respect to other minorities on job sites. I want to see women empowering women to be the changes that are needed. The changes I have seen and been a part of and have told you about today were all small acts. I commend women who are putting themselves out there as examples of community and what our jobs are all about. I'm really proud of the Facebook groups and the Instagrammers and LinkedIn and the TikTok creators who are generating visible representation. The more women and girls who see those posts and pictures, the more we'll know that these jobs are interesting and viable. And the more community support they have, the more women will keep these jobs and have long and successful careers. Tradeswork is not for the faint of heart, but women are strong. And I think we are going to see resilient and strong women stepping up to help the Canadian economy, their families, and to line their own pockets with the sweet paying jobs available in the trades. Ladies in the trades, keep advancing, keep advocating. I'd like to finish here today by thanking all of the trailblazing women who cleared the path of some even bigger obstacles before I got here. I'd like to thank all of the women who are here now, showing up every day, kicking ass at their jobs. These jobs take some serious grit. And of course, the women who are coming, you are the change. So, again, I'd like to thank Skills Ontario for organizing this Women's Day event. My name is Miriam Jordy, and you can connect with me on LinkedIn. I'm happy to answer questions and direct you to supports in your community. Thank you. Everybody, enjoy the rest of your day. Bye-bye.
Thank you so much, Miriam, for that great message, as there is so much we can do to support women in the workplace and to help remove the barriers they face in order to make the workplace better. The goal for today is to provide open conversation on topics that women face in the workplace and to provide strategies on how to overcome any of these obstacles. Our first group of panel speakers are true examples of how to overcome barriers in the workplace. Please welcome Ashley Pesneschny, Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Manager with Skills Ontario.
Thank you for the introduction, Antonia. Hi, everyone, and thank you for joining us in celebrating International Women's Day 2022 with Skills Ontario. As Antonia noted, my name is Ashley Pesneschny, and I'm the Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Manager for Skills Ontario. I am honored to be here with Sabrina, who is in carpentry, who is a carpenter, who will be sharing her experiences, her stories with us today.
Thanks so much for having me. It's great to be here today. I want to quickly note, thanks for calling me a carpenter, even though sometimes in my own mind, because I'm not Red Seal, I'm literally just a first year apprentice. I sometimes forget that, I guess I could be considered a carpenter, but a carpenter apprentice for sure.
Amazing. Thank you so much, Sabrina. So we're going to start off by asking you a few questions. Our first question is, were you ever discouraged from pursuing a skilled trade career? If so, what advice would you give to the attendees?
Absolutely. And I think it goes back to years and years ago in high school. Oddly enough, I took shop class in high school, and it was my highest grade that I got in my entire high school career. The only reason I took that shop class was because there was a group of boys in the hallway that were making comments that, you know, girls shouldn't be doing shop class. And they commented that, you know, if they had a girl in their shop class, that, you know, they would show her up. And I thought, you know what? So I marched myself up to the office, and I switched from, I think it was home ec or something, and I got myself into that shop class, and it was my best grade that I had my entire high school career. My father actually was not supportive of it as well. And so it was sort of the beginning of the end for me. I mean, I did great in that class. I showed the boys, they were making little jewelry boxes, and I made a deacon's bench, for goodness sake. So, I mean, there was a pretty significant difference, and the light should have, you know, went off, and you know, I should have realized that, hey, maybe this is your true calling. But because I really didn't have any encouragement, both from the boys at school and as well at home, my father really was not very encouraging and didn't want his daughter to be a carpenter. So I think his words were, you're far too pretty to be doing that. So here we are, fast forward, and you know, a few career choices along the way, and look where I am, right? I'm right back kind of right where I started, where my passion, you know, really was in the very beginning.
Amazing. Thank you so much for sharing that, Sabrina. Going on to that question, have you ever experienced discrimination or stereotyping in the workplace?
Absolutely. And I think, you know, we can say that we've, you know, all experienced as women, I think, discrimination in some way in the workplace, whether it's in trades or not in trades. But I think when you are entering a male-dominated field, you know, that discrimination is heightened to the 10th degree. And so where it shouldn't be, I mean, it's the year 2022 now, unfortunately, not everybody is, you know, up to speed. And so, you know, that is sort of the constant battle. So 100% I have experienced it. And I'll give you a few examples. Actually, when I went for my interview on a job for a company that I'm no longer with, and there's a few reasons, and I'll tell you why. My interview, they were surprised that I showed up in high heels and actually commented on it. Now, here's the thing. Yes, obviously, I'm not going to go out onto the job site in high heels. I strap on the work boots and, you know, away we go. But they said, oh, heels. That's interesting. The guys around here will like that. Now, I don't know about you, but any job interview I've ever gone for, I've always dressed a professional, you know, in a professional way. I am a woman, shocking. And as a woman, I will wear things that, you know, make me feel confident. And in an interview setting, I don't think it's inappropriate to wear a pair of high heels. You know, I had a pair of pants on and a button down top. And so, but I, you know, that was really something that stood out to me. And I kind of thought to myself, what am I getting myself into with this place? I'm not so sure. So that, yeah, that sort of set the tone, right? I mean, I'm a woman, but obviously, you know, I have done my pre-apprenticeship. I've gone to school. I've been doing this for a little while. Obviously, I'm not going to go out onto the job site in high heels. So that was one scenario, you know, and just the comment that the guys around here would like that, you know, it didn't sit well with me. So that's just one sort of scenario, that, you know, started off, sort of on the wrong foot. Another scenario that I can, think of is, you know, it's one of the things that I think women in trades are sometimes hesitant to do is ask for help when we need help, and also feel like we have something to prove. And so I found myself in that position. You know, in the beginning of my workplace, I, you know, was looked at as, oh, she's just the girl. She's just, you know, you just stand over there and look pretty kind of thing. And I actually think that had been said at one point. And, you know, I was trying to prove myself, right? I think that's what we as women in trades are constantly trying to do. We're constantly trying to prove ourselves. We're constantly trying to prove that we're worthy, that we're knowledgeable, that we can do the job. And sometimes that's not always a good thing. We're afraid to ask questions because we don't want to look like the girl who just doesn't know anything. We're afraid, you know, to say, oh, I can't lift that, because we don't want to be looked at as, oh, well, yeah, of course you can't lift that. You're the girl, right? So we'll, you know, we'll not ask for the help that we need. And so I think as women, we need to remember that we are part of a team. And I made the colossal mistake of wanting to be one of the guys. And it's the number one mistake I hear from so many women in trades, that they too were just trying to be one of the guys. Well, we're not one of the guys. Right? We're not one of the guys, but we are one of the team. And so I think, you know, if you can remember that, then you'll set yourself up for success versus for failure. Because if you're trying to be one of the guys and trying to lift something, I mean, let's face it, you know, I'm 140 pounds. I'm not going to be able to lift what my coworker who weighs 240 pounds, you know, it's just not possible. But, you know, if you, you know, sit down and have one of us try to do a equation, you know, on rafters or something, I could probably figure it out faster than him. So everybody has their place on the job site. It's just trying to figure out what your role is and, you know, breaking down the barriers and fighting that discrimination, because it's there, you know, being told to just go stand there and look pretty is not a good feeling. And, you know, for a while, you know, if you're the new person, what do, right? Like, do you speak up? Do you just go over there, stand there and look pretty and watch everybody? Do you try to go and get involved? Or, you know, like, what do you do? It's a very tricky situation to be in as a woman.
Now, if people are tuning in right now and they're interested in going into the skilled trades and they identify as female, are there any supports or resources that are available?
Absolutely. You know, one of the biggest, I think, bonuses for this day and age, the year 2022, is the internet and social media. It sounds crazy, but, you know, really, I turn a lot to women who are doing exactly what I'm doing on social media. I ask them for help. I ask them for advice. I watch their pages because often a lot of women will be very transparent and vulnerable and share their experiences. And so, you know, I can probably learn about how to react or adapt in a situation before I'm even in that situation, because I guarantee there's another female out there who has gone through it already and is sharing it on social media. So social media for me has been absolutely huge. It's also extremely motivating to see other women, you know, sisters doing this. And I think all too often, you know, sometimes when women are just starting out in the industry, they'll look at another female as their competition. And it's really got to be the absolute opposite. We really have to look at everybody, all females, as our sisters rather than our competition. And I think when we do that, then we're on the road to success. Sorry, my dog's bone did not last as long as I thought it was going to. One of the other resources I want to point out is Careers in Construction. Careersinconstruction.ca is a great resource online. It's an organization run by women for women in construction. And I encourage everybody to just go check it out if you're getting into the trades in Canada.
Okay, thank you so much, Sabrina. Regarding the topic of discrimination and stereotyping, have you noticed a change or improvement since you started working or going to school in the trade?
You know, it's one of those things that I think, you know, when you're ready to buy a new car and you're looking at everyone, you know, who has, if you're trying to buy a Jeep, let's say, all of a sudden you see 1,000 Jeeps, you know what I mean? So I'm not sure if it's something that I'm just hyper aware of, but I think I do see a positive trend. And I obviously think that there's a lot of room for improvement, but, you know, I'm seeing more women on sites. Like when I actually go out to a job site, I'm seeing other women, and it's so, so, so important to go over, because she might be brand new. This might be her first day on the job. So going over and making her feel welcome and, you know, really encouraging is so important as women, because we have to support each other. So I do think that it is changing, because, you know, just in my short time being in the industry, I am seeing more women on sites, whether they're the painters or, you know, finished carpenters or plumbing apprentices. I've seen a few, and that is really awesome, because, you know, when I first started out, when I was, you know, dipping my toes in and thinking about this as a career, I didn't see any women, you know, on a job site when I drove past. You know, I was always looking. I was always like, I don't see any women, you know. But now I can tell that, oh yeah, there's a woman out there. It's nice.
Okay, so Sabrina, we have one last question here for you. Do you have any advice for young women entering a male-dominated trade?
Absolutely. Number one piece of advice is know that your fears are really not real and they will go away. When I first started and went into my pre-apprenticeship at Conestoga, I was absolutely terrified. I remember my very first day at school and I was just like a nervous wreck. I had no idea what to expect. I mean, it's like any job or any time you're going into a, you know, school setting, you're terrified. You're terrified of the unknown. But that fear goes away with the, you know, the knowledge that you start to gain. And as time goes on, obviously we know you're going to become more knowledgeable and more comfortable in your skill set. And that fear, like, definitely, definitely disappears.
Thank you so much, Sabrina, for sharing your stories, your experiences. You truly are inspiring. So thank you so much for being here today with us.
Aw, thank you so much for having me. This is something that I really enjoy doing. If, you know, what we talked about today encourages one young woman to enter the skilled trades, then I think job well done. We did what we accomplished or set out to accomplish to do.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Ashley, and all of the remarkable panelists for sharing your experiences and advice with us. We are so happy you could join us today. Having the opportunity to share our experiences is how we can help the next generation to grow and excel in the skilled trades. When we talk openly and honestly, we are opening the door to allow the next generation to thrive. To continue with today's theme of Break the Bias, we are excited to have the opportunity to talk about a concern that many women have when entering the skilled trades and technologies: health and safety. Health and safety can take many forms, from the personal protective equipment, otherwise known as PPE, required on the job site, to proper fitting clothing, to performing tasks safely, to sexual harassment policies. Knowing and understanding your rights is important. To talk about this further, we are joined by two women who are very passionate about making sure women are safe in the workplace. Please welcome Tracy Muradian and Rally Shekharova.
Thank you, Tracy and Rally, for being here with us today. My name is Lindsay Chester, Young Women's Initiatives Program Manager with Skills Ontario, and I'm honored to be here with you both to talk about a very important topic within the skilled trades and technology: health and safety. It's not a conversation that is necessarily talked about, but it is one of the most important conversations that should be had, especially for any tradesperson entering into the industry. So Tracy, you are the Health and Safety Manager for Eastern Construction Company, and Rally, you are the Executive Director for Bolt, and you both have a lot of experience with health and safety and connecting youth to careers in construction. So to jump right on in, Tracy, can you tell us, what can someone expect when entering the job site, and what best practices can they use to complete tasks safely or to stay safe within the workplace? So this can be related to workers' rights, responsibilities, choice.
Right, a great question. Every new worker or any worker in Ontario is protected under the Occupational Health and Safety Act. I don't want to go into that in great detail, but that puts out legislation saying that an employer must train their employees, must have procedures, safe work practices and procedures for entering job sites. So things that we do at our company and in the industry is to have a site-specific orientation. So the day you show up on our job sites for work, you would be orientated on the things that you could expect that could put at risk and the controls that we're using to control those risks. Also, what your expectations are for your own responsibility for your safety, the employers and your supervisors' responsibilities are. So it's pretty strict and stringent, and you should be looking for those things anytime you go to a new employer, that you're receiving some training and some, and they're identifying where you could be put at risk and what to do to mitigate that.
No, for sure. Those are some some good points, and something that's coming to mind as well, just to kind of add on, are there any, health and safety reps within organizations or that employers should have?
Absolutely. So every job site, depending on the numbers, so 1 to 5, you're supposed to have a health and safety rep. You must be assigned a supervisor. So someone that is looking out for you, or assisting you look out for yourself. And then the joint health and safety rep on projects is someone who is chosen or selected by the workers. If you're not getting the answers or you need additional assistance with your, hazard controls and safety, you would be going to your health and safety rep on the job site. And that person's identification is posted in each job site. So it's very easy to find these individuals, and they will speak up on your behalf for workers. Okay.
No, that is perfect. That is really good to know. I've definitely seen that around our workplace. So I know it is a very common practice, but for those entering, that's definitely really good information so that they know who they can talk to. So kind of sticking along the lines of rights. So why is proper fitting personal protective equipment important, and why is this such a struggle for women? So I'm going to hand this over to you, Rally.
Thanks, Lindsay. And it's really great to be part of this panel. I think this is a really, really important conversation. And I love this question because we see it so often with some of the female youth that we work with and with female apprentices as well. So I would say that because women are so underrepresented still in the industry, the market for PPE and workwear just reflects that. So along with limited choices in the type of items that are available, sizing is the other biggest issue for things like shoes, reflective vests, overalls, jackets, and even things like gloves, tool belts, and safety harnesses. And the reason why this is an issue is that if you are a petite size, this can make you uncomfortable on site and restrict your movement. So you're not having, like, you know, the best day. It can slow down your productivity, you know, if you're just fidgeting with your gloves and trying to adjust everything. But in the worst case scenario, loose fitting PPE can actually put your safety at risk because it can get caught on site, including in things like heavy machinery. So, you know, having more choice, if there's anybody who is in the industry, having more choice and more sizes available to women, I think would make a really, really big difference, because there are specialty stores, but not as easily available and as easily to find than menswear for the industry.
Yeah, no, for sure. And, you know, that's something that always seems to come up a lot in conversation as well, is, you know, trying to find that proper fitting gear. And, you know, we're starting to see some companies emerge. Off the top of your head, is there anyone who you would recommend for workwear for women, or where women should look?
Yeah, you know what? We do. I mean, maybe Tracy wants to jump in on here. There are specialty ones that we like better. And you sort of put me on the spot here. I don't have one, but we should put this a list on our website to recommend on our women's and construction section, because I think it's a really important topic. Yeah, Tracy, I'm not sure if you have any that popped to mind.
It's been problematic. And sometimes even when I see manufacturers, like I remember walking into Works Warehouse when I was in the field doing water and sewer, and finally finding one of those jackets that had three layers. You could, you know, take layers of stuff, and it was made in a very small size, designated as women. Well, that was like 1 year I found it, and it wasn't there any longer. So, you know, I think they try the market. Sometimes things don't last, so they don't put it in. As far as harnesses you brought up, and I'll make it really quick, those are sized by your weight, your height. They cross your chest, they cross your hips. Our chests, our hips are different than men in a lot of way. So it's very important to get the proper fit. There are a couple of manufacturers out there who are now sort of trying to manufacture or design towards women, and really want to come with suppliers and go to the manufacturers for fall protection specialists, and they can usually find you something. There's a couple out there right now that they've made for women. So,
oh, that's great for sure. So to keep the conversation moving, so we're going to stay with you, Tracy. Has there ever been a task that you could not physically perform safely? If so, how did you overcome this?
Oh, boy. Yeah. And I think it's not just once. I think that's very common for both men and women. I don't think it matters. There are always jobs out there that are sometimes a little tricky to perform safely, but there's many things you can do to offset this. You can change your tools. You can look into specialized equipment. You have to use your teammates sometimes, or just simply the change of process or the means of methods of doing the work. So if you think you're going to do your work in one way, you may have to look at getting somebody to assist you. So if something lifting that's very heavy, or something that you need to enter, maybe an excavation or something that's unsafe, if you're going to be looking at putting in equipment that holds the box and stuff. So this is all we do as a safety professional. We do work with a lot of safe work practices and procedures, and those can be things that we put in place at the worker, be it PPE to mitigate risk or unsafe things like sharp blades, sharp tools, things like that, or engineered things like shoring systems and so on and so forth. And you learn about all these as you start getting into the trades.
No, that's definitely great. And it seems just like the teamwork and the team support too is always great to have. And it seems like, you know, everyone's always willing to help each other on the job site. So that's definitely kind of a good point too, is, you know, having those around as well and all of that. So thank you for sharing that. Oh, sorry.
It's okay. Sorry. And we didn't share, it kind of links to the first bit, and we didn't really dwell into it, but workers have three rights, and the rights basically are to know, participate, and to refuse. So there have been times when I've been requested or having to complete some work, I was unsure, I didn't know what I was doing with it, didn't feel it was safe, and that's where you need to stop what you're doing, speak to a supervisor, get reorientated on that, come up with a new procedure. So those are your rights. You should never be, there should never be reprisal for that. And these are things that are by law, you're allowed. So in the industry, these standards stand there.
Yeah, I appreciate you actually saying that, because, you know, as a person enters into the skilled trades, maybe they aren't aware necessarily that they have the right to, you know, refuse work or to refuse unsafe work. So I think just hearing that, and that's good advice for anybody, right? To know that if they do feel unsafe, they don't have to perform that task. They, like you said, they can step back and reevaluate and, you know, ask questions. So thank you for bringing that up. So Raleigh, we're going to move back to you as well. So health and safety is a large conversation that does not just include physical injury, but can also include things like harassment. So what are some of the best practices and policies you have heard of, and what recommendations do you have for women in trades if they're running into these issues?
Yeah, this is a really great question and a really important topic. And I'm sure Tracy would agree that it's so great that harassment is being talked now in terms of health and safety, because going back to that team environment, it is team environment. And if you have that negative relationship with someone because of bullying or harassment, and you can't trust them to be your teammate, then that actually can really create a dangerous situation. Never mind, you know, the personal toll that it takes on someone's mental health and emotional well-being. And I think the other reason like that's really important is because toxic workplaces can really drive women, racialized individuals, and even youth out of the industry at a time when there's a huge need for new entrants. So I would say, you know, lots to talk a little bit about like how it is now. I would say lots has changed in the construction industry to make it more inclusive and diverse work environment for those underrepresented groups, including women, than even 10 years ago. And while women are still, I would say, very much underrepresented, there is increasingly more women in the industry, and they're also in more senior and managerial positions. And all of that is actually driving both cultural and system change at the site. There's lots of work that still needs to be done. I don't want to say, you know, like we're all done here. There's work to be done, but there's certainly a lot of progress that's happened as well. And I think the other driving factor here, and this is a really important point for employers, is that the widespread and growing, I would say, labor shortages also means more competition for workers. And it's forcing employers to review their internal practices and ensure a positive work environment that can contribute to that recruitment and retention of the labor force that they need. So ultimately, employers need workers who are dependable and who are skilled. And if their current HR practices are not creating that environment for retention, it's a strong motivator for them to review that and change those policies. In terms of resources, I would say that there are some really fantastic female focused, you know, union chapters and groups like Ontario Building and Construction Tradeswomen that offer a safe space for tradeswomen to share their experiences. They offer career resources, mentorship, training, events, all with the goal of sharing those experiences, sharing strategies, and helping, you know, tradeswomen advance in the industry, right? And sort of share those best practices and best next steps. So to the second part of that question, I would say if you ever experience harassment on site, the number one thing is you have to speak up about it. And I'm not necessarily saying, you know, go straight to your employer or to your colleagues there, but you can even share the incident with someone that you trust in the industry, like someone that's been a mentor for you with your career, to talk about the next steps, what your options are, and so on, if you're not comfortable, you know, bringing it forward immediately to your employer or your supervisor. But having said that, the best advice I can give is that you need to do your research to find an employer that will have your back and that has that positive, you know, reputation in the industry. And the industry is not very big. Bad employers are well known and good employers are well known. So just asking some questions would really get you to better understand what the work atmosphere is like, and if you can depend on someone there to look after your rights and your needs as an employee. You can do a quick online search, you know, some of this ends up in the media as well. And you can also do that during the hiring process to ask them what their internal policies are in these types of incidences. I'll give one example, Tradel, which is Canada's largest condo builder and our founding and principal sponsors. In 2020, they launched the Build for Respect campaign within the residential sector. And that includes mandatory training for staff, a clear reporting process for any bullying, abuse, harassment, or discrimination behavior on site. So my sort of summary and the key things I think anybody should look forward in an employer when it comes to this issue is they should have a zero tolerance policy. They should have established and confidential reporting processes. They should have known repercussions for offenders. So if an incident takes place on site, you should have an idea of what the range of, I don't want to say punishment, but it is punishment that will take place. And you also, this part is very critical, you want to make sure that all of these policies are actually enforced with that employer, which is writing is one thing, in practice is completely different.
No, that's a lot of great information for sure. Honestly, the more the better, right? You know, that's our goal. We want everyone to be informed of, you know, not only their rights, their responsibilities, but of these policies and, you know, really what employers should be doing to protect that employee, right? You talked about retention. If you're not going to protect your employees, you're not going to keep them. And I think that ties in really nicely to the last question, which we're going to pass over to Tracy. And that is, how can someone go about finding a safe employer and what should that look like?
Oh, that's a really great question. And I think it, you know, Rally touched on some of it. A safe employer is one that has clear policies and procedures, training, reporting, and follow-up with their employees. And it's not just initially when you're hired, but it's once you're already working with them that you still receive a refresher and training on this. You know, Rally's right. Interview your employees. You think it's just your employer that's going to interview you, but interview your employer, ask them questions, you know, if this was to happen, what, you know, what would the policy or procedure be? You know, ask them, you know, how they would handle these situations if it was specific to some type of harassment. But just as a safe employer in general, in the industry, we have the Ministry of Labor does track and the WSIB does track incidents and injuries to workers based on different trades and different industries, whether manufacturing, residential, or IC&I construction. You can go on to websites like WSIB has a website and bring up something called Compass, and it will show all the major employers who are playing WSIB and what their injury and accident rates really look like. So that's really, you know, key to do some research, look at their website, see what their policies or procedures say about being safe. Are they actually doing what they're saying they're doing when you're employed, as you start working? And, you know, if you start with an employer, do not hesitate. If you're coming and against non-compliance, you're not feeling safe, it's not being corrected, it may not be the employer for you. You have a lot of years to work. You need to work with a safe employer, someone who, you know, provides the PPE, who provides the training once again, and the supervision to you as you're learning your role. We don't expect you to just start a job just because you've come out of school. You should be a, you know, a field engineer and know all the risk there. It takes a long time to learn some of this. So you want to have good people, you know, also watching your back. This is what a safe employer looks like. All of these things combined, they need to have open communication, open door policies for you to feel that you can go to your supervisor, you can go to, they're telling you who you can go to have things corrected and to be listened to if you feel unsafe.
Yeah, again, a lot of great information. And I actually like your point on interview the employer. That's something I personally would never really thought of. I would have just been like, all right, interview me, life is great. But that's actually a really good point, right? And you know, we are approaching day and age where we, you know, we want to be safe on the workplace. And I think that's a really good point, is to ask your employer or potential employer those questions, right? We need to know ahead of time. And like you said, it might not be a right fit for you, and that's okay, especially when you're starting out. We have many years within our career. So I definitely appreciate those points for sure. And overall, I just want to thank you both so much for this amazing conversation. There was a lot of really good information and a lot of really great points that were highlighted. So thank you again, both, for being here and for providing us with this insight into health and safety.
Thanks, Lindsay.
Love the opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you again, Tracy and Rally. As we move through the event, don't forget to get sharing on social media with our event hashtag, SkillsIWD 2022, and Break the Bias. We have been participating in some great conversations throughout this event, and we are proud to be able to continue this conversation with our last group of speakers. We have hit on topics such as discrimination in the workplace, knowing your rights and being safe, how to be supportive of women entering the skilled trades, and now we are going to talk about allyship. What does allyship mean? Why is it important? And how can we be allies? To lead this conversation, please welcome Kayla Bailey, a journey person, steam fitter, gas fitter, and welder. Welcome, Kayla.
Thank you for the introduction. My name is Kayla Bailey, and I'm a journey person steam fitter with UA Local 46 Toronto. I'm also proud to be the current project manager for the Ontario Building and Construction Tradeswomen, a committee of over 400 tradeswomen from across Ontario. As Antonia noted, we have been talking about some important topics related to women in the skilled trades and technologies. I am honored to have the opportunity to talk with this amazing group of women about this important topic, allyship. Having allies within the skilled trades and technologies can make a big difference, especially if you are just starting out. Please let me introduce our speakers. Vindra C. Gobbin, a journeyman millwright, Melissa Curry, a sheet metal apprentice, Emily Pike, an automotive service technician. Thank you so much for being with us. Let's get things started. Why is it important to be talking about allyship and being allies for women in trades?
I think it's important to be having these conversations, right? To get the word out that, allyship exists, that there's endless amounts of, maybe not endless amounts, but there's many programs out there for tradeswomen, lots of help, lots of support, again, communities, and I think it all starts with having those conversations and to keep having them, to keep getting the word out. Because I know for myself, like, I didn't know until I was well into my career, I didn't know that this community exists. I didn't know that the OBCT existed, and it has been pivotal for me. It's been life-changing. It's really helped in my career. So I think we need to keep having these conversations and keep getting the word out and even more advertising.
Thank you, Melissa.
I think it's important to be talking about allyship also, specifically allyship, just to hold people accountable to their actions. So, like having male allies, having someone speak out against discrimination in the workplace and things like that, definitely beneficial to hold people to what they say and bring awareness to it.
With the allyship too, I would say it's probably a really good for sort of adding on to what Emily was saying there with having the males on the workplace that would actually speak up for us as well. There's strength in numbers, right? So even if it's a couple of girls, and if you can get a couple of guys to be speaking up for you too, it helps to get the word out a lot faster to help the situation problem itself.
Absolutely. Thank you, Vindra. Where does allyship need to start?
I think allyship needs to start like right away, right in high school. So for me, I started my automotive career in high school, and I was taking automotive courses.
And I had an auto teacher that actually made all the women sit in the last row of the classroom. And I mean, I was the only one that really, I was mad about that. Like, I was furious. And if I had more people back me up on that, then it probably would have gotten resolved a lot faster. I mean, all the men in the class agreed that it was unfair, and everyone could see that we were getting treated differently, but nobody would say anything. And when I spoke up, everybody looked at the ceiling. They were like, oh, wow, Emily's doing something, but nobody acknowledged it. Nobody would say anything. So, I mean, right in high school, starting early and just speaking up for unfairness.
Thank you, Emily.
Yeah, for sure. I would have to agree with Emily. Very, very well put. I too remember the days in high school, you know, and where I was too afraid. I was too afraid to take a woodworking class. You know, I for many, many reasons, but one of I just didn't feel I would fit in. It was, you know, all males. For me personally, I was also struggling with my sexuality at that point. And, you know, I figured if I joined the woodworking class that I would, people would know I was a lesbian, and, you know, all these things, right, that really hindered me from pursuing something that today I'm so passionate about. You know, I love all sorts of construction, and yeah, so I mean, for sure, even before high school would be ideal, right? Like, I would say the earlier the better.
Thank you, Melissa.
I was always a tomboy. So I would say it would be as early as possible. I was constantly under all my cousin's elbows in the garage, getting greasy from head to toe. I had little fingers, so it fit in spots that theirs couldn't. And then as I got older and I was in high school, I was usually the leader of the bandwagon trying to get stuff noticed, changed, fixed. And if nobody joined me, I would just tally-ho anyway, right? Sometimes you kind of gotta be a little bit of a lone wolf. And then other people watch and they go, oh, hey, she can do it. I should be able to do it too, right? Kind of leading by example without even realizing it, depending on your age. But as early as possible, I would say, start them really young.
And I think too, for myself, thing I've learned, sometimes, you know, the allyship doesn't always... It doesn't just appear, you know. I've learned, and this is just my story, but I had to kind of go out and look for it at times, right? So maybe if I don't get the answers or the resources that I need right away, I gotta continue to go out and look for it. And this has been a reoccurring issue in my life, like not even in terms of my career, but I was that young girl playing hockey on an all boys hockey team, you know, changing in the closet because there was no girls leagues, right? And now I love seeing how we've evolved that way. But you know, come to find out, it did exist back then. It just wasn't right in front of me. You know, I came from a small town, and who knows? I could be playing in the Olympics right now if that didn't happen. I blame the lack of allyship.
Thank you, Melissa. What can hold someone back from being an ally?
I'd say probably the fear of judgment from your peers. I mean, the biggest thing for all of us here is that we work in male-dominated fields, so we're surrounded by men and we're the odd ones out. So speaking up against, you know, a bunch of men for one person, it definitely stands out and it makes people feel more judged, I think.
There was a girl that actually left our local. for a very similar reason to that, she tried. She tried and tried and tried, but the guys kept pushing her aside. You know, they tell her to go be the gopher, run on the tools back and forth. Oh, you can't lift that, sweetie. It's too heavy, you know. And she actually tried to pick my brain about it a little bit. And I told her, I was like, you got to just push them back out of the way. Show them you can do it, right? Tell them to go grab a tool. And then when they come back, you're in there. Sometimes you just, I don't know, you got to dive right in head first. Show them what you can do in order to gain their respect. It's not easy to do. If you don't have the confidence in yourself, or at least the want to be able to even prove it to yourself, it's a lot harder to try and prove it to other people, I find.
Yeah, definitely. I would have to agree with that. I think, you know, something that can hinder or stop someone from wanting to be an ally, fear, sometimes ignorance, right? Just simply not knowing. You know, for myself, like I make mistakes often. I misgender, I use the wrong pronouns at times, you know, but I think it's important to, get ask questions and learn from your mistakes, right? But yeah, I'm a big one on, I think some people are just, they just don't know, right? So maybe some additional training, education out there, you know, get the education out there and simply, and again, get those conversations started.
Actually, I think that's a really good point, is people just not knowing. I mean, I've had customers that come in and they say they want a real technician. And then when they see me, it's like, no, I want a real technician, like a real one. And my service manager thought he was helping, he was solving an easy problem. So he just gave the job to a different technician. You know, he genuinely thought he was helping. He was like, oh, I was just trying to get that customer to like back off. But you gave it to a man. You took the job away from me and you thought you were solving a problem, but you really weren't. You were hurting me to give this guy what he wanted. And I mean, he recognized it after, but it should be recognized beforehand.
Thank you, Emily. That leads into the next question, which is, what can allies do when they make a mistake?
I guess learning from your mistake and learning from the mistakes of others. Because, I mean, if you do it once, that's one thing, but to do it twice is just ridiculous. I mean, if my service manager hadn't learned from that experience and like realized that he had done something wrong, and actually hurting my career because we're paid per job we do, and he just took that job away from me and gave it to somebody else. If he hadn't learned, I probably wouldn't have stayed with the trade for very long because I'm losing out on jobs then, and it's not fair. But yeah, learning from your mistakes and watching and learning from the mistakes of others too is a big one.
Yeah, and I would have to say, like, apologize through action. Right, like Emily said, you know, everyone makes mistakes. We're all human, and things are forever changing. Right, we forever keep learning. But I think, you know, own it and apologize through action. It's something I teach my daughter. Right, like change the behavior. Let's learn and just carry on. It doesn't need to be made into a big thing. Like, let's just apologize through action.
Thank you,
yeah, Melissa. I would agree with both Emily and Melissa there. Own it, for sure. Don't make excuses. And don't try to shrink away from the fact that you made the mistake. apologize to your action, learn from your mistake, figure out how to do it properly the next time, and ask the guys that you're working with if somebody else is available, pick their brains for the knowledge, right? Especially if they're, I find sometimes sometimes it's some of the older guys on the job site, they're a little bit harder to, because they have daughters too, and they look at you almost like a daughter. So they have a harder time almost putting you in the danger zone if there is one on the job site. But if you turn around and you tell them that you need, I had to do this to a couple of guys. I turned around, I told them, I said, I need your brains, not your back, because you're going to retire and I'm still going to be here not knowing how to do this job. So teach me how to do it properly. Yes, I screwed it up. Show me what I did wrong. Help me to understand it so that I can do it just as good as you did or better.
Absolutely. Thank you, Vindra. That's a great point.
Yeah, I really like that. Thank you, Vindra. I'm gonna use that for sure. And I can identify with that. You know, I can always tell the coworkers that have daughters, right? For sure. And I mean, in my opinion, equality goes both ways. That's all I want, you know? So if you're a jerk, I want you to evenly be a jerk to me too, you know? I appreciate that. Thank you, Vindra.
Thank you, Melissa. So we've seen a lot of advertisements and recruitment of young women into skilled trade careers, but yet the retention rate is still so low. What can employers do to help support women in the workplace and to encourage allyship among all employees?
Bring the trades back in schools. Big time. Put the shops back in there, get the kids in there so that they can learn and see and do and make mistakes in a controlled environment and learn from it. It's also, I found a couple of manufacturing facilities around here, they do like a family day, and they'll actually get to walk through the entire plant or a portion of the plant with their young kids. And they get to look around and see all this stuff. And it's like, ooh, those are robots and they do all kinds of stuff. You know, daddy works on that or mommy gets to fix that stuff. It just puts it into more of a real perspective for kids, because you can tell them all you want till you're blue in the face. But when they actually see the thing and how huge it is or how complicated it is, or how like maybe even scary it is, and they go, wow. And it's almost like they find a whole new appreciation and pride in what their parents are doing for a career. And it just sort of builds it up. It's almost like a little bit of confidence that starts to grow. And then curiosity sparks too.
I love that. I really love that. That's a great idea. Now I forget what my answer was, because that was such a great one. What can employers do? I would say advertise, like promote the women that they have, like advertise by the treatment of the women that you have, because we're a pretty tight-knit community. Like we all talk, at least in the automotive industry. Like I know tons and tons of women in my area, in my industry. So I mean, if Ford is a bad place to work, we all know about it. And if Subaru is a great place to work, we all know about it. So I mean, just starting in your own house is a really great spot to start.
Yeah, for sure. Yes. I think too, you know, I had a hard time answering this question. I got to be honest. I don't necessarily agree with, you know, I know that the government and locals, you know, are making attempts with mandates and ratios and incentives and stuff like that. But I don't want to be given a job or kept at a job because they have to. You know, I want to be given an equal opportunity to get me in the door. I want to bust my ass. Sorry. And allow myself to stay there. Right. In an apprenticeship in Canada, there's something called the AIG, an apprentice incentive grant, right? Two times in your career, you are entitled to $1,000 after you complete a block of schooling and you pass, okay? Males receive $1,000, women receive $3,000. So I think it's great. Again, they're trying, you know, they're trying to keep women in the trades by doing this. But I can tell you that one of the most uncomfortable situations I experienced in my apprenticeship to date was when I was in trade school and all the males, because I was the only female in the class, which happens often. I'm the only female in my 353 members in my local. And those males found out that I get $3,000 and they get $1,000. And we all had the same struggles. It was one of the most uncomfortable situations in my apprenticeship. And they should be upset. We're all going through the same things. And that's not going to make me want to stay in the trade. Yes, it's great. You know, everybody loves money. But at the same time, I feel like it's kind of putting a Band-Aid on cancer. You know, it's not getting to the root of the issue. So although I appreciate the attempts that are being made, I just want that equal opportunity to get me in. You know, I'm a good worker. I'm completely capable. So I don't know what the answer is, but I do know that, you know, some changes need to be made. You know, how can we really promote an equal opportunity?
Well, we can promote it by being given it, for starters. I mean, I don't know about you guys, but I've definitely experienced like unfairness, being treated differently in a bad way for being a woman. And I think getting $3,000 was at least a little bit better for putting up with that. I mean, the men don't have to put up with that. We all get treated like jerks, because that's how we all treat each other, which is fine, but like I do get it more than the men. And $3,000 was at least a little bit to make it worth it.
100%, like totally, I get it. And I too, you know, experience it often. There's certain men that will just never ask me for help, right? For an extra set of hands. My thing is, you know, so when the $3,000 is spent and say I'm licensed and I'm at an equal pay grade, then what? You know, then, you know, I don't know. I just might not, I'm not probably going to stick around.
There was a situation a few years back. The Millwright Regional Council of Ontario was planning to begin recruiting females, and the aim was to be able to reach a 50-50 status as soon as possible. Yay! But the way that they were going about it, I did not agree with whatsoever. And similar to Melissa, I was the first female to get hired in Kingston local. They did not want to hire a girl. They were very apprehensive about it. And I persistence paid off. I dropped a resume off every Friday until they finally called me for an entire summer. And I got in. But I just lost where I was going. What was it that you said, Melissa?
Just about mandates and...
The mandates, right. And the hall was, or the council was trying to do 50-50. So I actually got the opportunity to attend the annual meeting I believe it was the year before that they were planning to actually put everything in action. And I got to speak to the president of like the Ontario Council. And I got his ear at after hours at the hospitality kind of thing. And I just told him, I said, if you were planning on recruiting a bunch of females that are not interested in this job, do you really think that you're going to be doing any of us any kind of benefit? Females or the trade in general, any of our other members? There are people that want to do the job and they have the passion and the drive and the care to put into it. But if you just go and scoop a whole bunch of girls out of a school somewhere or out of any situation and throw them into this, just like Moses was saying, they might stick around for a little while because it's a paid apprenticeship. Yay. But at the end of it, is it really worth them sticking around if all they had to do was log the hours, show up, not actually put the work in, and then get a ticket, right? You didn't do anything to earn that for yourself. You didn't work hard to actually appreciate the job that you were doing or the ticket at the end of it being the reward, being like your main goal. Right? And it's a similar kind of idea with being handed everything. You don't necessarily appreciate what you've got, and sometimes you just always want more. But if you actually put some blood, sweat, and tears into what you're doing and what you want, and aim for that goal and work hard for it and slip and fall a few times and then get back up and keep on going, you appreciate that end goal, that ticket, that title, and that pride, that sense of pride that you got at the end of it, right? You're proud to say that you're a mechanic. You're proud to say that you work in the automotive industry. You're proud to say that you're a carpenter, you're a pipe fitter, you're anything. You're proud to say that you work at an office, whatever, but you had to actually put the hard work in order to appreciate it and want it, right?
I just don't want that hard work to include like going against the bias. Like, I don't want younger generations to go through half the crap that I did. Like, I get wanting and needing to work really hard to get this license. Absolutely, don't get handed it. But they should not have to jump through even half or a quarter of the hoops that we all have. So, I mean, we got to figure out something to promote the trades and get people to want to do it. But I agree, absolutely do not push people into it and make it less jumping through the hoops, especially for women. Like, being put through half the stuff that we did was just, it was not great, and I would not wish it upon anybody else, for sure.
Absolutely. I strongly agree, you know, hence why showing up tonight, you know, speaking to these young women, right? That's a start. You know, and it always, for me, it comes back to, you know, why not put some money into training? I'm employed through a union. Great decision I made in my life. My safety training is like top notch every year, annually, right? So why can't we put some money towards having that as part of our annual training? Call it sensitivity training, safer space training. You know, consistency is going to teach us, right? All of us. But I totally agree, Emily. You know, if we got to start making changes, and because I don't want these young women to think too that it's, you know, maybe I feel like I'm talking a lot about the negative parts, and you know, I just want you to know my experience hasn't been all bad. Like, I have a killer job. I love my job. I've worked with some really great men, really great people. And again, I've gained their respect.
through busting my ass, right? And continuing to show up and remain teachable. And it was really tough at first, but I feel like I've worked with some really great journeymen and tapped into their knowledge, and I get excited about my career and where it can go. You know, there's so many trades that my trade anyway, there's so many different avenues I could go. Even today, like I was welding and I was, you know, working with copper, and then I was making some duct work, you know, like it's just painting. Like I do multiple things every day. I have great benefits, great wage, and job security too. So it is possible. Come join the trades.
Thank you so much for such great dialogue on the last question. And, you know, I'd just like to say that, you know, we have all had to jump through a lot of hoops throughout our careers. And I'm sure that those hoops are not over for us yet. But I'm also sure that every single one of us has probably changed quite a lot of minds out there. And I think that, you know, we're looking towards the next generation and some of the young women that will be watching that video. I think, you know, all of us will have an impact on the workplaces that hopefully they choose to join and come and work with us. What an amazing conversation. Thank you so much to our panel speakers for sharing their insights into what allyship means, why it is important, and how we can be allies to each other.
Thank you so much, Kayla, and to our panel of speakers for sharing their thoughts on allyship and why it is so important. We have tackled some big topics today, inspired by the theme, Break the Bias. It is these conversations that will allow us to come together, stand united, and ultimately make for a more equal, inclusive, and diverse world for all women. We would like to extend a huge thank you to all of the amazing women who contributed to our event today and helped make Skills Ontario's International Women's Day a success. Without the sharing of stories, wisdom, and advice, we wouldn't have been able to put this event together and give women entering and or currently in the skilled trades and technologies the information they need to succeed. If you haven't already, don't forget to take a picture of today's event and post to social media tagging Skills Ontario and hashtag SkillsIWD2022. Or post a picture using the Break the Bias pose to show your support for creating a diverse, equitable, and inclusive world. We would once again like to thank our Young Women's Initiatives program sponsors, the Government of Ontario, Magna, and General Motors. Thank you to everyone who joined Skills Ontario's International Women's Day Virtual Conference 2022. It has been an engaging event, and we want to continue encouraging young women to pursue their careers in the skilled trades and technologies. For more activities and events, please go to our Skills Ontario website and check out all the upcoming opportunities in our Young Women's Initiatives programming. And don't forget to fill out a quick survey available at the end of the conference. Your feedback is important to us. Thank you for joining us, and together, we can break the bias.